Welcome to the video recordings of Lancaster Brethren in Christ Church, located in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. LBIC is a community being transformed by the love of Jesus, sharing this love with all people. Our desire is for this online video content to be an extension of our community, allowing for a visual and more personal connection with familiar voices, helping us think about how to follow Jesus in our particular moment. So enjoy the video, and we hope to see you soon in person.
And with that wake-up call, welcome to Sunday morning service. We are glad you're here, and to those who are watching as well, I'm creating some problems too. It's a beautiful, beautiful Sunday morning, and I invite you to stand. Actually, stay seated. This is a new song, so it's going to be something to get acquainted with, but it is pretty simple. And as we enter into worship, I invite you to meditate on the words, and if you get accustomed to the melody, I invite you to sing along. We believe in the name of Jesus, who is our saving power, our healing power. We believe in the saving power, in the saving power of the name. We believe in the saving power, in the saving power of the name. We believe in the saving power, in the saving power of the name. We believe in the saving power, in the saving power. Mighty fortress, a balm for the weary, a refuge and our strength. His name is power, a strong deliverer. We believe in Jesus' name. We believe in the name. We believe in the name. We believe in the name. Okay, on the second verse, I invite you to join with us. We believe in the healing power. We believe in the healing power, in the healing power of the name. We believe in the healing power, in the healing power of the name. His name is justice, a mighty fortress, a balm for the weary, a refuge and our strength. His name is Jesus' name. We believe in the name.
morning. Welcome to Lancaster BIC. It is great to have you with us this morning on this beautiful, crisp fall morning. I'll get to announcements in a little bit, but I just wanted to say that it is wonderful to have each one of you with us here this morning. And I see a few new faces, so I always feel like it's important to let you know if you're new here, we want you to know where the restrooms are. And that is, if you go to the far side of this building, there's a little porch, go up through that door, and on the right-hand side, there is a bathroom if you would need to use that. We will continue in worship this morning as I read Psalm 124. If the Lord had not been on our side, let Israel say, if the Lord had not been on our side, when people attacked us, they would have swallowed us alive. When their anger flared against us, the flood would have engulfed us. The torrent would have swept over us. The raging waters would have swept us away. Praise be to the Lord who has not let us be torn by their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the fowler's snare. The snare has been broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we thank you that we can gather this morning to worship you, to acknowledge who you are as our Lord, as our Savior, as the one who is deserving of all of our praise. Father, we ask that in this next hour together that you would turn our hearts and our minds to that which you have designed for each one of us this morning to receive. And we ask, Lord, that in this time also that you would be receiving of the praise and the worship that we offer to you. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
I invite you to stand.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise him. Alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Alleluia. 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 Thou rushing wind that art so strong, ye clouds that sail in heaven along, oh, praise him. Alleluia.
There's a mighty rushing wind, the breath of God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we worship you this morning. We give you praise, and we welcome you to work in us today. You are the one who is faithful. Amen. Blessed be your name, roadblock with suffering, there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the moon's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory. Give and take away, my heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away, you give and take away, my heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. Darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been. So good, with every breath that Your goodness is running after me.
Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness, your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. The goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
You may be seated. A few announcements that I have to share with you this morning as we continue on in our morning together. The first is that we're having a lunch today for those of you who are newer to LBIC, just so that you can get to know the staff, get to know a little bit more about who we are as a church. And even if you did not sign up ahead of time, we are planning for extra people, so you are welcome to stay if you're newer and you'd like to learn a little bit more about who we are as a church. Starting next Sunday, we move indoors, and I've been lamenting that a little bit, but today is maybe a good hint that it might be about time for us to do that. So we will start with two services, one at 9 and one at 10:30. We will ask for people to wear masks. That's our request. We will offer the same thing for children indoors as we have been outdoors as we get started. We may be able to add a little bit to that as we move, but we just need to build up our volunteer base and do a few more things before we add anything else to that. But I did want to point out that there was a paper on the welcome table this morning. For those of you who have children, it looks like this. And we would ask that you would fill that out, and you can put it in the offering basket, or you can just hand it directly to me, just so we get updated information about your children, contact information, if there's any allergies or anything special that we need to know about your children. Also, if you are interested in volunteering with children's ministry, I'm going to have a real brief meeting next Sunday morning at 10 o'clock between the two services. So it'll be real brief just to let you know just some of the first steps that you would need to do in order to get involved in children's ministry. I think that's all the announcements I had. Woo. I cannot talk this morning.
You can't talk. That's okay. No, you can stay here. there is something called the branch on the table, too. And so that's kind of like a newsletter that we had typically put out on a monthly basis when we were inside pre-COVID, all that kind of good stuff. We're resurrecting it, at least for today, because we have stuff that we want to communicate with you all. And so basically the two big things that are on there is, one, a recap from our town hall meetings that we had a couple weeks ago. And that was just kind of some information, up-to-date sort of stuff for us to know as a church family. And it's not just like to do action-oriented sort of items. It's also some philosophical things as we approach going back inside and as we continue to gather as the church and be the church in the midst of a global pandemic that's still going on. So if you didn't pick that up, please do that. On the bottom of that is also another piece of information that is, for me, and I think for us as a church family, pretty exciting. So we have some news, good news, to share today about Pastor Jane. She's not leaving, thank the dear Lord. Yeah, I know, me too. I tried to sign her to a 10-year contract, which she denied, but that's, oh well, whatever. I'll still work on that one. But the piece of news to share is that as you've experienced during my sabbatical over the summer, Jane has considerable leadership gifts and also has been exploring in her personal life over the last several years some training in spiritual formation, as have I. And so her role is going to shift, not immediately, but over the course of probably the next 9 months or so. So she's our associate pastor now, which also has under that umbrella children's ministry. What we're going to do is take that section of ministry and look to hire a part-time children's pastor. And so we're going to take that off of her plate in order for her to focus on leadership and spiritual formation stuff alongside of me. And so I'm really excited about that. She's really excited about that. You all should be excited. I'm telling you what you should be excited for. It's just, I think where we're at in terms of church life and the direction we're heading and those kinds of things, it's a good and necessary move for us. So just to give you a little bit of time frame over the next couple months, we hope to have this position hired for by the end of the year, by the beginning of next year. By all means, if this is something that piques your interest too, let me know. We have a job description that I can give you. It'll also be posted on the Brethren in Christ website. But I can let you know that information. So the hiring process will be happening this fall. Hopefully, God willing, we'll have somebody hired by January. Jane will then help them transition into the role from about January to May or June. Over June, then, she'll have some time to shift responsibilities and prepare for next fall in 22? If you guys can keep track of your years anymore, good for you. And she'll switch into that role then full-time. Not full-time. At her normal 28 hours, her full focus, there you go, will be in that area of ministry. So anyway, appreciate you so much. You're awesome to work with, as are the rest of our staff, not discounting you, Brian and Kira. You guys are awesome as well. But this is, I think, a significant move for you and for us. So yeah, anyway, do you want to say anything? No? Okay, good. I'm supposed to dismiss the kids now. There you go. All right. Kiddos, you can go with Pastor Jane now. I'll get that to you in the email this week. But, some good news on the Snyder family front. Little Micah is doing very, very well. And so he's been pulled off of most of the stuff that have been supporting him over the last couple weeks. And so that's really good news. If you guys have Bibles, which would be a great thing this morning, or if you have phones with the YouVersion Bible app or something, Bible-oriented, turn to that, open that, and go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and we'll start in a minute at verse 17 and following. If you're just joining us this morning, we are 3 weeks, this is our third week, into a series of messages talking about our three values as a church family. Number one being Jesus-centered, that's what we've been talking about the last 2 weeks, we'll end talking with about today. Number two being relationally focused, we'll spend the next 3 weeks on that. And then thirdly being justice-oriented, 3 weeks on that afterwards as well. There's something, as we think about being Jesus-centered, there's something that we do and participate in every week that acts out this value, that makes us participants. Not only, we talked about this before, but value is not something that is just cognitive, it's something that's experienced. And so there's something that we experience every week that helps us to be a Jesus-centered people. And if you can guess what that is, I want to talk about receiving and participating in communion or the Lord's Supper or Eucharist. If you're new here with us, actually, there are elements on the table every week that you can grab, and so you can have that ready when we receive communion later on. But we've not always done this as a church family. In fact, in my life, no church that I've been a part of has received communion every week. That's probably because I've not been a part of a high church, like a Catholic church, a Lutheran church, an Episcopalian church. My background is Mennonite or Brethren in Christ Assemblies of God or Church of God. And so I've not been a part of a tradition in which this piece of worship was central. But several years into pastoring here, and this is my first senior pastor. It's been 10 years now, but it's the first one I've been a senior pastor for. I have been thinking about what it would look like to make communion kind of the central focal piece, the place that we all move to week after week. This is what more liturgical churches or higher churches do. Communion is the center point of that. And I have to admit, I had a selfish motivation at first. Because as a younger pastor who had to preach every week, and this was a new experience for him, for me, I wanted to be able to land at a place that it didn't matter if I did really well or not with a sermon. Or I wanted to land in a place where it didn't matter if music went really well or not. I wanted to land at a place that centered us on Jesus. And I was like, how do we do that? Oh, we can just adopt what the church has been doing for a couple thousand years. So, in 2016, what we did as a church family was teach through, and it was during the season of Lent. I taught through the meals that Jesus had with people. So I framed our understanding of communion not just at the Last Supper, and that's typically where people go. They go to the Last Supper, to the night that Jesus was betrayed. But they forget that Jesus had over 20 meals that were recorded with people throughout the Gospels. And that meal that Jesus had at the Last Supper, the disciples had no idea when it was happening, what was going on. It's in retrospect, they understood it. But my conviction then and my conviction now is that the meals that Jesus shared over with 5,000 or with 4,000 or at the wedding at Cana or at Simon's house with the Pharisee and the prostitute, all those meals shaped our understanding and shape our understanding of the Last Supper and the communion meal. And so we taught through that for about 8 weeks or so. There were meals that Jesus had with tax collectors and zealots and folks that didn't make the cut. And that was just at the Last Supper. Before that, Jesus had, I just mentioned it, my favorite one comes from Luke chapter 7 when Jesus was at Simon's house and you have this Pharisee, so this staunchly religious, pious man who has it all together on sitting at the table. And then literally kind of creeping up to the table on her knees was this woman who was a prostitute who begins weeping and washing Jesus' feet with her hair. Both of them were at the table, and Jesus, not the Pharisee, was the host of the table. The Pharisee might have thought he was the host of the table, but he wasn't the host of the table. Jesus is redefining what the table means. That was a fun one to think about. What we're going to talk about, though, today comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and regrettably throughout church history, though, the table has been redefined time and time again by the church, and it's been redefined in such a way that it's been made harder to access. At best, and I do think there are good motivations for this, There have been restrictions that have been imposed in hopes of protecting the meaning of the table. That's a best case scenario. At worst, and I think more often, restrictions have been enlisted as a way to maintain power and control. This happens denominationally. This happens in a local church with a priest or a pastor. But the restrictions have been a way to maintain some sort of control over the people. Now, before we you have little baggies now. Before we had baggies with elements in it, I would invite us forward to a communion table in the sanctuary. We'll eventually get there again someday. Who knows when? But when I would invite you, saying, "Whoever desires the grace and mercy of Jesus is invited to come." All that to say that at LBIC, something that's good for you to know, especially if you're newer, so not only is communion a core practice for us, something where we meet Jesus every week, but we practice something that's called an open table. We don't give qualifiers who can come and who can't come. We figure that if you want to show up here on a Sunday morning and hear what we talk about and hear the offering to receive communion, there's a part of you that's at least intrigued by Jesus. And so if you're intrigued by Jesus, we also trust and want to cooperate with what God is doing in your life and what God is doing in people's hearts. And I don't know about you, but I can't tell what God's doing in your heart. And I don't think you can tell what God's doing in each other's heart. I'm making the assumption that because you're gathered under the name of Jesus, whether you're a follower of Jesus or not, you're at least intrigued by the person of Jesus. And if you're intrigued by the person of Jesus, then the Spirit is doing something in you to draw you to Jesus. And so here at LBIC, we don't say, you know what, you've got to do this, you've got to do that, you've got to jump through this hoop, you've got to believe this or that in order to come. If you're here, if you want to receive the grace and mercy of Jesus, you're welcome. That's what we do in practicing the open table. And I firmly believe that this generous openness of the table honors the work of Christ, which I believe is larger and more beautiful than any of us can comprehend. But as Paul says, we see through a glass darkly, and sometimes we base both our theology and our practice off of our dark sight. And so what I'd like to do this morning is walk us through a passage that has been the defense passage of the communion table. This is the passage that priests and preachers and denominations have used to keep people from receiving the table that Jesus prepared. Not that I prepared this morning, but that Jesus prepared. So this table is defined by Christ. It's not defined by me. It's not defined by you. It can't be co-opted by anybody. Jesus has defined what this table is. And so I hope to suggest today that this is the very thing that Paul is speaking against, the exclusivity of the table. And here's what I think is the irony of this passage, is that this is the passage that has been used to exclude people from the table, when what I think Paul is doing here is criticizing that very thing, criticizing exclusion and the practice of exclusion within the church. So let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 17 through 34. We are going to tick down through this couple verses at a time in order to understand what's going on here. Before we address these verses, a little bit of background on the Corinthian church. 1 Corinthians isn't Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. There is another one that's referenced before, and by far, it is the most contentious relationship that Paul has with any of his churches. And they're two of the longest letters that Paul writes to any of his churches. In total, at least he's written three letters to the Corinthians. We just don't have one of them. Now, Corinth was one of the wealthiest Greek cities. It was an economic and cultural center. The believers that comprised that church came from Gentile backgrounds when Paul planted these churches during his missionary journeys. And throughout these, and you'll even see it and you'll hear it here, you can feel that there's a little bit of an edge to Paul's writing here. So let's start reading. In verses 17 through 19, this is what Paul writes. In the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you. And to some extent, I believe it. This is Paul's sarcasm kind of cutting through. No doubt there have to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval. Let's pause there. So the meetings that Paul is talking about in verse 17 are when they come together as a church. Okay, so this is a church meeting. Now keep in mind, in this time, there are no church buildings. You are meeting in homes, and most likely you are meeting in the homes of wealthy people because they have houses that can house at least probably around 50 people. And so it's the wealthy who are the hosts of many of these church meetings. And Paul has no praise for them because divisions exist among them. And this is something that Paul's been addressing throughout the letter. In the opening chapters, he continues it here in the practice. This is something that is embedded within the Corinthian church. Paul is speaking against division. Holy moly, we could probably, the church in the U.S. right now, read this letter over and over and over and over again, because divisions exist in us over what I will say are silly things. We're selling out Christ for silly stuff. In verse 19, Paul speaks sarcastically like he does in the opening chapters. He says, no doubt there have to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval. And so Paul is critiquing the divisions that exist within the church. And anytime you have divisions anywhere, you have exclusion. Anytime you have division, you have exclusion. You have people who are in, and you have people who are out. Let's continue, verse 20 through 22. So then when you come together, it's not the Lord's Supper you eat. So he's talking about something very specific when they come together. For when you are eating, some of you go ahead with your own private suppers. As a result, one person remains hungry and another one gets drunk. Don't you have homes to eat and drink in, he says? Or do you despise the church of God by humiliating those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you? Certainly not in this matter. Paul's getting to the heart of the problem. So let's look contextually just at what's happening here. Here's what's happening. The wealthy who don't have to work because of whatever reason, they're in a Greek and Stoic society, and the Greeks, they don't apprise labor. They don't value labor. In fact, labor is something that's looked down upon. You're a lower class of person if you actually have to work for a living. These people like to sit around and talk about ideas all day long. And so these people who sit around and talk about ideas all day long are able to show up to these houses of their wealthy friends early. And so they get a jump on the meal. They not only get a jump on the meal, they get a jump on the finest of foods that are there. And by the time anybody else shows up for their church meeting, they're already drunk. They've had their fill. Another thing that's interesting is in these homes, in these houses, you would have, when Paul says you eat privately with one another, the houses are set up where there's the small dining room. And the small dining room is where the privileged guests sit and eat, and it's also where the finest foods are served. That's where these people are gathering. And then the people who come later, because they had to work for a living, have to sit outside of this special table. It's like the adult table for the Bible. Everybody else has to sit at the kiddie table. Only the adults can sit in that space. And so Paul is critiquing this. There is a division that exists that they're allowing happen. And it's not only that they're allowing it to happen, but they are taking the cultural values of division and exclusion, and they are enacting them within the church. Let me emphasize that again. They are taking the cultural values of division and exclusion. Pick your item of division or exclusion, but they're adopting them and making them a part of the fabric of who they are as a church. And Paul has no room, no praise for this. Let's juxtapose this for a minute to John's accounting, and John doesn't have communion imagery, Eucharist imagery. The other three gospel writers do, but John gives us this other scene that is around the same communion table. Let's juxtapose these people who show up early, who get drunk, who are separated from what Jesus does in John 13 in John's account of the Last Supper, when Jesus takes off his outer cloak, kneels down, takes the water, and to begin to wash feet. There's this posture of humility. And we're called to do the same thing as we are together as the body of Christ. This is one of these passages that gives insight into the presence of the Lord's Supper, communion at the early church. And so it was a very integrated part of their worship together. But this is what N.T. Wright says in his critique of the Corinthian church. He says, when they're coming together to celebrate the Eucharist, they are reinforcing a social distinction which has nothing to do with God's intention in creation and nothing to do either with God's achievement of salvation through the Messiah. And then so Paul continues on in verses 23 and 26 to remind them what it is they are doing as they receive the Lord's Supper together. This is kind of the invocation that we give each week. Paul says, for what I received from the Lord, I have also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took the bread and broke it. When he had given thanks, he said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you're proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. After Paul shared these words, which are part of the tradition of the early church, remain a part of the tradition of the church universal, he has further instructions. He reminds them, this is all about Jesus. And then, in these following verses, he rebukes them for what it has become. And this is also, these following verses that we're about to look at, is the part of the scripture, of this passage of scripture, historically and presently, that has been used to exclude people from the table, which is what I suggest exactly is what Paul is arguing against. So let's take these next few verses. Verse 27, so then whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Let's talk about this unworthy manner, because it's certainly been used throughout church history non-contextually. Contextually, what's it mean? It's a matter of division. It's a matter of an exclusion based upon who has and who doesn't have. It is a matter not of considering, of not considering your brother or sister who has been made your brother and your sister through the body and blood of Christ. An unworthy manner is any way that creates the haves and the have-nots, the rights, the wrongs, the sinner, the pious, the theologically staunch, and those meandering to find their way. When we do this, the focus is not on the body and blood of the Lord. It is not on the work of the cross. It's on ourselves. As N.T. Wright said above, it's reinforcing social distinction. And we are using, when we do this, the ways of the world, ways of exclusion, ways of superiority to police the table, or to consider ourselves more worthy than another to come to the table. Paul continues in verse 28. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. I sound differently now. Wow. Well done, Steve. So these lines, along with the notion of an unworthy manner, are lines that have been used to keep people from the table. This is what Howard Marshall says in reading these verses. His warning was not to those, Paul's warning was not to those who were leading unworthy lives and who longed for forgiveness, but to those who were making a mockery of that which should have been the most sacred and solemn by their behavior at the meal. Regrettably, as I've spoken on communion over the years, as I've shared with other churches or other pastors, or just peep lay folks, I've heard stories about pastors or leaders communicating that before you get to the table, you better make sure there's no sin on your life, in your life, or you will be drinking against the body and the blood of the Lord. Well, that would be really easy, because then we would just never practice communion. Nobody would be welcome up here. If the case was a sinless life, good grief. Nobody would be welcome. Nobody would come. But I come to the table because of the sin of my life. I come to the table because the invitation that Jesus makes for sinners to dine with him. Remember, one of the critiques of Jesus throughout his earthly ministry is that he eats and drinks with sinners. Non-examination, not discerning the blood, body and blood of Jesus, taking it in an unworthy manner. All of these don't have to do with the presence of sin in our lives that keeps us from the table. Rather, it is this, the arrogance of not recognizing we come as guests to this table. Jesus determines its meaning. We don't. Jesus determines who's invited. We don't. And I've given this challenge before, and I will give it again. But who can you see Jesus not inviting to his table? Who? Now, I'm so glad that Paul throws these cryptic verses in verses 30 through 32, because these are just fun ones for anybody to tackle. But they've also been used probably in not so helpful ways. This is what Paul writes in verse 30 through 32. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep or died. But if we were more discerning with regard to ourselves, we would not come under such judgment. Nevertheless, when we are judged in this way by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be finally condemned with the world. Okay, if a teacher or preacher ever grabs onto this one with excitement, stop listening. Okay? People grab all too readily upon this as a tactic, really, of fear. But I think there is a very reasonable way to read and to understand this. And it's not, I mean, the impression, either because of how we've been trained to think about God or as we've heard it spoken, the impression is that if you come to this table in the wrong way, watch out for the lightning bolts, baby. That's kind of the impression that either pastors, preachers, or teachers have used or that has been ingrained to us because that's the image of God that has been given to us. That I would argue is counter to Christ. But what's Paul doing here? Here's what I want to suggest. Paul is addressing a dysfunctional community. Paul is addressing a dysfunctional community and the effects of a dysfunctional community. He's addressing a divisive community, the community that has some getting drunk while others literally starve. After a long day of work, they don't even have any food or access to food at the church table. A community who has some working their fingers to the bone while others sit around and just swim in the realm of ideas. Now, if you talk to any psychologist or therapist, they will tell you that dysfunctional communities breed illness. Dysfunctional churches breed illness. This is what Paul is getting at. It's not some supernatural, oh my gosh, what's going to happen if I take this communion in the wrong way? I'm going to get struck by lightning. It's there's so much dysfunction in this community that people are literally starving. And it's not only the physical means of starving. You also know what it's like to be in a dysfunctional, maybe some of you coming from dysfunctional families, certainly a number of us dysfunctional workplaces. They do not contribute to your health. They take it away. In some cases, it makes you physically ill. I know of one pastor who pastored a church that I interviewed at, didn't get the job, thank God, but he worked there for 10 years and ended up becoming incredibly ill because of it. And he only put that two and two together because when he took another church, his health incredibly improved. That's not magic. That's dysfunctional community. That's healthy community. That's not being supported and loved. That's being supported and loved. We know this in our families. We know this in our workplaces. And we know this in our churches. And in the U.S. right now, what's coming to surface is the dysfunction of many of our churches. And that is something all of us participate in or don't. You all are contributors either to the health of your church family or to the demise and dysfunction of it. You are contributors to the healing of one another or to the making sick of one another, the cause of anxiety and worry, the knots that form in our stomachs, the eggshell walking that is just so rampant in churches, the divisiveness. We determine whether that happens or not. And by God, I'll lay down my rights for you in order to have community. I'll lay down my rights for you in order to follow Jesus. I won't sacrifice community. I won't sacrifice a oneness in Christ. I won't sacrifice the cross of Christ because I want my opinion to be right. I would rather join Jesus with a basin and a towel and serve the person and wash the person's feet who's going to betray me or deny me or abandon me. That's a vision for the church, friends. We want to bear witness now. Bear witness in loving one another well. Don't spiritualize this. It's practical. They're sick because they're making each other sick. This is what happens when you go off script for 5 minutes. I'm going to go off script for another 5 minutes. I continue to believe that the greatest witness of the church now is laying down our lives for each other. And I continue to believe as I see and that as I hear that the greatest threat to the church is not external. It's not external. People want you to focus externally right now. They just want to take away your own personal responsibility for your own actions. They want to argue about something that's existential and ignore the people that are right in front of you. My concern for the church, how? As a pastor, as a people, how can we have maskers and no maskers together and love one another? How can we have people who have been vaccinated and not vaccinated together and love one another? How can we have people who are across the political divide that has really few hopes of coming together? How can we bring those people together? Because this is gospel. Jesus bringing Jew and Gentile together. It's the togetherness of the family of God that is the witness of Jesus. How do we fight for that and stop fighting each other? Paul ends with a few verses. He closes. He has a so then. So then, my brothers and sisters, when you gather to eat, you should all eat together. Anyone who's hungry should eat something at home, so that when you meet together, it may not result in judgment. And when I come, I'll give further instructions. This passage has been used historically to exclude people from the table, and I believe it's actually a passage that speaks to exclusion within the church. It's about how communion brings us together, how Christ brings us together, in what is naturally, by the world's standard, separated. How does Jesus bring us together? Paul encourages us to eat together. Before you come together, prepare yourselves. You might, he says, eat something because that's to his context, right? But how do we prepare ourselves to come together? How do we prepare ourselves for this place of worship? A place to surrender ourselves, to submit ourselves, to humble ourselves before God and before one another. That preparation of ourselves is Monday through Sunday. It's what we're doing in our lives to cultivate the fruit of the Spirit, to be open to the fruit of the Spirit, to the Spirit moving in our life. It's what we do to be myopically focused on the person of Jesus and what it means to be truly human. We prepare ourselves so that as we come together, we bring these hundreds of lights together and make one bright light together that points to Jesus. And so, one of the things that we do as a community is we receive communion. We don't take communion. It's not something that we grab like a snack, even though it's in snack bags currently. It's something that we receive. We come to it with a posture of reception, with open hands. And Jesus puts into these hands, these sinful hands, these broken hands. He puts his body and he puts his blood into these hands so that we might be united with him and through him united to one another. That's why we receive together week in, week out. Brian, you can come a while. There's some reflection questions for you all, but I would encourage you all, either in home churches or in conversation with spouses or friends or just in personal reflection and study, mind the depths of what is offered to us at the table. There are so many implications of what happens and what this represents, what this embodies for us as we receive communion together. Let me just pray for us. There we go. That's always helpful. Lord Jesus, I want to offer us just an opportunity, each of us individually maybe, and then just collectively, to just search our hearts of the ways that we have kept people from the table. Like, who is hands off in our lives, who we just don't think. We might say, yeah, they're welcome to the table because Jesus welcomes them, but there's a whole difference between Jesus welcoming them and me welcoming them, and I don't need to do that. I don't want to do that. I can't do that. Who are those folks for you? Who lies across the divide? Who are you excluding? Jesus, I know that there are folks that are very hard for me to include. But Lord, I bring my heart to you today, and I want to be reconciled to you, and I want to be reconciled to my brothers and sisters, believers and unbelievers alike. God, I want my heart to be that of Christ that breaks open for the world. And I pray for us as a church family, God, that you would plant that seed in us, that desire in us, that passion in us, that resoluteness in us, Lord, that wants to see your body be one and bearing the light of Christ as one body, under one Lord, under one faith, under one baptism. Father, forgive us for all those ways that we fall short. And Holy Spirit, I just pray for your convicting power among us. Give that gentle jab to our spirits when we're out of line, when we're looking at others in the wrong ways, when we're contributing to the exclusiveness and divisiveness of the world that's around us. Jesus, we thank you that your work brings together. And all these things we give you through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Jesus asks, Are you weary? Are you heavy laden? Come, and I will give rest for your souls. And so I invite us all, let's come to the table, and let's receive rest for our souls.
You want to take your elements. You join me. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Jesus has prepared this table before us. On the night that he was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it and he gave thanks. He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's receive together. And after supper, he took the cup. And he said, this cup is the new covenant poured out in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's receive together.
I invite you to stand and let's affirm the work that Jesus did on the cross.
Pray together. Lord Jesus, I thank you for bringing the work of the cross, bringing us together with you and with one another. The work of the cross defeated death, and that almost seems, bridging the gap between division almost seems as big of a thing as overcoming death. But Lord, you've done that. And Lord, you're giving that as work for us to do to implement the work of Christ on the cross. Give us such a great love that we might reflect your bringing together. We give you thanks for all these things. We thank you, Jesus, for your work. It's not just once and done, but it's a work that you continue to do and to give us to do. By your Spirit, help us to do it well. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. Go in peace. If you are newer here and you want to hang out for some lunch, a little Q&A, I promise you it'll be lighter and maybe a little more happy than the sermon. So, we'll meet and congregate here. There's some picnic tables in case you didn't bring chairs or whatever. But just see me right away because we're ordering pizzas. We're going to keep it to like an hour, hopefully. So you'll be at least leaving by 1 o'clock. You won't make kickoff, but it'll be close. All right? So see me or Pastor Jane right away so we can get stuff ordered. And just come over there and meet us. Thank you so much. God bless.